I was walking along a sidewalk, and this father and little son and daughter, they were on bikes. The two kids were on little bikes, and I was going on the right side of the sidewalk, and this little girl was like tottering on her bike, and she's like, and then she goes, well, right towards me, and it's gonna hit me. So I real his dad said, look out, and I very nimbly hopped 1 foot off on the grass on the side of the sidewalk, and then went past her like that, just sidestepped her just like that. And she said, sorry. Yeah, well, yeah, if I hadn't have been nimble enough to sidestep it, I would have gotten hit. All right. Very interesting little anecdote here to start the day. Talk about, synchronicity. Synchronicity is always happening, actually. And when we tune into it, it's amazing. And then we say, well, that can't be possible. Maybe I've used up my quota. It's always there. It's always there. Yeah. It's always there. And maybe this be synchronicity for all of us. This video, maybe for you, this is synchronicity. Because what a video we have here. What a video we have. I'm doing great, doing great. Better and better and better every single day, actually. So, do we have a practice here? We certainly do have a practice. It's really what we say is the familiarity problem is the only problem we have. I used to say continuity problem. People couldn't quite understand what that meant. So familiarity problem is it means the same. We like things to stay familiar. In other words, we like continuity. So we want ideas to be ideas we're already used to, right? Unfortunately, what we're used to is absurdity. So we stay absurd. We stay locked into absurdity. What is that? I don't know. Some creature flying along with a septic there. A pine needle. What kind of insect carries a pine needle around? I don't know. So familiarity is the key, and it's our problem because we're vastly familiar with absurdity. Absurdity, of course, being when spirit tries to change what it is, where does it go to believe it's possible? It can't go to reason or truth. It has to go to absurdity. It can't even go to lies. Okay, because lies can easily be contrasted with truth, whereas absurdity, what can you contrast with absurdity, really? So absurdity is the what we're familiar with. We've really been into it for to such an extent that we're vastly familiar with it. So we expect our expectations are that everything, all ideas, thoughts, perspectives will be familiar to us, which means they have to still be absurd. So it's a severe problem, isn't it? Very severe problem. So I say the only problem we have is a familiarity problem. We don't have a war problem. We have a familiarity problem. We don't have a population problem. We have a familiarity problem. We don't have a human problem. We have a familiarity problem. We don't have a death problem. We have a familiarity problem. The familiarity problem is the only problem there is. There is no other problem. And wow is the answer to the familiarity problem. We can say that, wow. I used to say the vision of oneness resolves the familiarity problem. Well, but how do you abide in the vision of oneness is the question. And so really we have to practice the wow practice, and blocking the wow blocking of panic is how we resolve the familiarity problem. So we to resolve the familiarity problem, we have to understand how it resolves. And it's kind of like my ear, putting eardrops in an ear, like if you got wax in your ear, you put eardrops in your ear. The doctor says, well, it's going to be worse for 5 days or so. It's going to be all blocked up, but it's loosening all the wax. So when we do a familiarity practice, we focus on some idea that we're not used to, that's not absurd, that's true. And what happens is this causes shock, familiarity shock. So we feel worse for a while. Okay, it's the way of the cross means you carry your cross of unfamiliarity. Truth, we're very unfamiliar with truth. So we're biased against it. We're biased towards absurdity. So there's that little insect again. What is that? Some sort of wasp or something? I don't know. Yeah. I went into a spider's web, maybe with a pine needle, and it's attached to it. I can't really see it. It's, huh. So we practice hearing an idea that's true. Listen to truth. We keep repeating it. We keep repeating it without trying to judge: is it true or false? Because we're biased. We understand we have a familiarity bias. So don't try to say, is this true? Is this false? And draw conclusions. We're just trying to gradually dissolve our bias by becoming familiar with this idea. Once we become familiar with the idea, then it's easy to look at it and say, oh, it's true. I see a reason shows me that that's very true. And it's not a problem anymore. But getting to that, temporarily, you might feel worse. Like today, I feel really good. But by practicing, I'll probably feel worse because I'll be in shock. Practicing what we're not familiar with, non-absurdity, truth, is quite shocking to us, because we say, why don't know what to expect. If I get a hold of that, what else can I expect from it? And so we get very jittery. It's very shocking to us. So what we have to do is to block the panic that arises out of shock, unless we block the panic. Have to block the panic. So we say, I do have a conclusion, which is wow. I do know how to function, which is wow. I'll function as wow. I do have an identity, wow. A status, wow. Okay, a continuity, a familiarity, which is wow. I'm familiar with the wow. Yeah. So that blocks panic. So we need to feel it. Identity, status, continuity. Identity, status, familiarity, wow. And functionality, wow. My thinking is wow. My planning is wow. So I have plans, they're wow plans. I have thoughts, wow thoughts. I have identity, wow identity. So we say everything is stable. Everything is stable enough to block panic. We don't have to have it ultra stable to block panic. We just need to have a little bit of stability. It's like you're in an ocean and you've got a little boat in the ocean. That's non-sinkable, let's say, okay? Like someone stand-up paddling across the ocean, they had this, you know, boat that could flip over, but it wouldn't sink, and they could flip it back over. It was unsinkable. Wow, it's like this unsinkable little boat in an ocean. So as long as we have that, we don't have a cruise ship on the ocean, but we have this little boat, we won't sink. And as long as you know, I'm not sinking. The panic isn't there. The panic isn't there. And we know this current is taking us towards home. So we say, I'll get there soon enough. And I certainly won't sink. And it's like that. So wow is this unsinkable little boat on this, you know, otherwise inhospitable ocean of absurdity, actually. And so we're not in the ocean of our old expectations. We're practicing a new idea, a new way. But once we get shocked, we go below the boat inside and close the hatches and say, boy, I hope I'm okay. I hope I don't sink. I hope I don't sink. I know I won't sink now because the hatches are all closed and nothing can happen. The boat cannot be submerged. Wow, I have a wow identity, wow identity, wow status, wow familiarity, wow thoughts, wow plans, wow reactions, wow conclusions, wow past, wow future, wow now. This blocks panic, and panic is what sinks the ship, because it was jumping overboard. Really, don't you jump overboard. Throw the old ideas overboard, but don't you jump overboard. Panic is like panicking. Say, I got to go back to what's familiar, and you jump into this, you know, inhospitable ocean of absurdity because that's what's familiar. But here we say, no, I'm not jumping into the absurdity. I'm going to just stay right in the wow. That's familiar enough. There's nothing too much to grab a hold of there, but it's floatable. You're floating. They have these styrofoam like floaters and pools where you can see, like you sit on it, and you sink down in the water till the water's about up to your close to your neck, not quite, yeah, about right your neck almost, but you don't sink any further. It's amazing, and you just float there, and you get, it's a great practice, and you feel like, ah, I'm safe. As long as I have my head's above water, I'm safe. No reason to panic, and I know why, because I'm sitting on this float. It's a great practice to do that. I have one of those little floating seats. Time to practice that. Yeah, absolutely. Great practice in trusting the path, trusting your practice, trusting the wild practice. Now, this practice is needed. It has to be done because truth and absurdity are, you know, night and day different. There's no way you can be familiar with absurdity and claim that you're also familiar with truth without actually practicing getting familiar with truth. You cannot just read something in a book and say, okay, I got it. That does virtually nothing to resolve the familiarity problem. Familiarity problem is extremely severe, which is why we all keep failing here. Most fail to resolve this issue, the familiarity problem, because they don't work on it at all. They just hope that they get lucky, basically. Win the lottery, win the spiritual lottery and go to heaven. Doesn't work that way. The original sin we have really is this familiarity bias towards absurdity. Very, very, very extreme bias. But it, because naturally we love truth and don't love absurdity at all, all we have to do is practice, keep practicing, and the attraction and love of reality and truth is a great current that pulls us towards home, really, towards realization, recognition, realization, acceptance. So it's not like, you know, even though the familiarity problem is very severe, there's this great underlying current if we keep from jumping back into absurdity. You see, but if we jump back into absurdity, then that negates our success. That's for sure. It's like we're going in the opposite direction, kind of. But our attraction to reality will keep pulling us back to practice, pulling us back to practice, and we might. So today, this morning, I practiced. I sort of had a blank mind for a long time. And then it just came to me. There's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. What it was I had this dream. And there was this, this house was almost done. And there was this one area that there's someone was working on this. Some sort of plumber or was doing some sort of work. Or I don't know. Maybe it was the hot water heater guy was doing work, and he said, almost done. Just give me 10 minutes. I said, it looked like he had a lot of stuff to still do. He said, just wait 10 minutes. And I thought, I don't want to wait 10 minutes. Previously I was told, like 14, like what was it, 13 years ago, probably, wait about 15 minutes. Well, it's been about 15 years. And now I hear someone tell me, wait about 10 minutes. Just give me 10 minutes. Well, that means give me 10 years. And I said, I said, can I do something with this waiting? Waiting for what? Well, he's working on fixing something, is what he was doing. And then I recalled what Jesus has said in Dialogue on Awakening, that there's nothing to fix at all. We don't need to do anything. There's nothing to fix. Only absurdity believes there's something to fix, this dream. So he said, if you really want to go fast and effectively, just say, there's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. So I'm not going to wait 10 more years. I'm going to practice right now. Because you know what? After 10 more years, you'll have a dream where somebody's working on your kitchen. And they'll say, well, you know, we're not quite ready. Speaking of a kitchen, I had another dream that was very intense and pointed out what's likely to take place in this world. The universe is always fixing problems because spirit believes that its desire to change what it is just a problem it needs to fix. It can't do it yet. It says, "Well, I don't know how." Spirit says, "Well, I don't know how to change what I am." So that's a problem, and I need to fix that problem. I need to know how to change what I am. I need to change what I am. I got to know how it. So I got to get the know-how. So this universe is the attempt to get that know-how to for spirit to change what it is, to change itself into an hallucination, actually. It cannot happen. So always there's problems to fix here because you try to do the impossible and you see it as a problem to fix. As a matter of fixing the right problem, you have to have problems that keep arising so you can keep working on fixing them, hoping that that'll provide the solution ultimately. And what Jesus tells us is just there's nothing to fix. This is all just a dream. He says, why keep working on fixing dream problems? There's no need for it. There's no way spirit can change what it is. So there's no way to learn how to do it through fixing, through any way, through fixing problems, for waiting for problems to be fixed. Why try to fix a dream problem? Just stop dreaming. So that's the goal, is to just relinquish this dream, absurdist dream of problems. So if we whatever we fix, there's in this dream, the very purpose of the dream is to present problems. So it will most certainly present more problems. So there's nothing to fix. This is a super practice. There's nothing to fix. Wow. There is nothing to fix. Wow. If you do just that. Now, do not try and evaluate the practice as far as it being successful, is it not being successful? Just say, wow. It's being wow. There's nothing to fix. And this is being wow. There's nothing to fix, and this is being wow. There is nothing to fix, and this is being wow. There is nothing to fix, and this is being wow. So what we're doing is we're practicing, we're just getting familiar with this idea. There's nothing to fix. Just getting familiar with it. This removes the bias towards absurdity. We try to kind of level it out a bit, level the playing field. So don't expect instant results at all. Remember, we're just trying to get familiar with it. It takes a while. Takes a while. There's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. There's never been anything to fix. And there never will be anything to fix. There's nothing to fix in the past. There's nothing to fix now. There's nothing to fix in the future. There will never be anything that I need to fix, ever. There's nothing to fix. I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. There's nothing to fix. I am being wow. So I'm doing this practice because I know, I have the faith, and I know how this works. The familiarity is the only familiarity problem is the only problem that we have. Resolve this, work on this problem, and truth will certainly dawn upon us. And we, but don't try to figure out how does it dawn. Figure this out. Just keep practicing. That this is a, such a powerful truth. There's nothing to fix. Extraordinarily powerful truth. So just get familiar with that, and you will save yourself thousands of years of misery. Just get familiar with that. There's nothing to fix. Wow, my being is wow. I'm being wow. I'm being wow. There's nothing to fix. There is nothing to fix. I'm being wow. Just that simple. There is nothing to fix. There is nothing to fix. I am being wow. Or just wow. I am wow. There's nothing to fix. All is wow. There's nothing to fix. Just wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. So maybe say it 10 times. That there's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. There is 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 nothing to fix. Wow. You can start with saying it 3 times. There is nothing to fix. Wow. There is nothing to fix. Wow. There is nothing to fix. Wow. I can say, there is nothing to fix. I am being wow. There is nothing to fix. I am being wow. There is nothing to fix. I am being wow. Now this produces some shock, no question about it. So I'm not feeling as good as I was before, right? But it's very similar to like taking a walk and you come back and you feel a little tired after taking the walk, a little bit achy. But you know it's strengthening your legs, and your whole system is walking is good for us. So you'll feel better tomorrow, probably, or the day after, so it's like that, and for some of us, we forego that this recovery phase. Like, if I just stop walking for a week, I probably someday I feel like, oh, I feel really great, but I say, you know, I'm gonna just keep walking every day, and probably feel a little achy and tired every day, but I know I'm building up, you know, greater and greater and greater strength every day in this way. So that's very helpful. If you work out in some way every day, and you never quite feel that great, but overall, you know, it's just more and more overall strength it is accumulating, building up for you. You don't get to enjoy it so much, but the payoff here is in the frame of reference shift. So we don't really worry about a payoff prior to that. Don't expect it. Don't expect it. The spiritual path pays off all at once. Frame of reference shift. And big payoff. That's the ultimate payoff. But before that, don't expect a payoff. Just keep working. Because we keep reinvesting resolve in stronger and stronger truth that resonates with even greater simplicity. I mean, just to say there's nothing to fix is just totally counter to all absurdity, isn't it? Totally counter to the whole universe. There's nothing to fix. There's never been anything to fix. There never will be anything to fix. Wow. My being, I am being, wow. I am being, wow. I am being, wow. So this creates quite a buzz. It's the way to counter stoner culture, really, which is coming in many, many ways. Stoner culture in the 60s, 70s, and probably continuing these days, is everybody smoking pot. You know, you get a culture based on being buzzed, being high, on drugs. And so we have our practice culture, our wow culture. We have a wow culture built on getting buzzed from doing right spiritual practice. The wow practice. That's the culture we have. And that checkmates the stoner culture. Because when everybody is walking around in an altered, you know, altered state, we think, oh, geez, you know, I'm being left out. But this here is a slightly altered state, actually. State of shock, of success. So the stoner culture never pays off in any way. It's just a way to make you feel good about absurdity. Try to feel good about it. But this practice does pay off with the frame of reference shift. Where we literally can see, are aware, directly, without any question, that there's nothing, where there's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. It becomes absolutely self-evident, intrinsically self-evident. But that's only comes from a frame of reference shift. That there's not, we should not try to intellectually grasp this. That's nonsense to even attempt it. Because it's effortless. As long as we have effort associated with effortlessness, directly associated, like a concept, attempt to hold on to a concept, obviously we cannot experience effortlessness when we're making effort. And yet we do have this extremely severe problem of familiarity bias. So the effort goes into resolving that. Once it's resolved enough, once the fruit is ripe enough, it'll just drop on its own accord, by its own weight and ripeness. The stem gets kind of soft, the fruit gets ripe, and then drops from the tree of absurdity. See, we're trying to drop from the tree of absurdity to the ground of reality. Frame of reference shift. But that only takes place when we indirectly work on it indirectly by solving the only problem there is, which is a familiarity problem. Absurdity cannot grasp reality. Okay? Absurdity can't do anything at all. It can't understand anything. It cannot, so it's absurd, and it dances as absurdity always. So we have to let go of absurdity. We have to stop desiring absurdity. We have to stop trying to change what we are. Once absurdity departs, then reality is self-evident. It's obvious without any need to make it obvious. So you cannot make the obvious obvious. That obscures it. We just have to be willing to accept that there's nothing we need to do at all. There's nothing that needs to be fixed. There's nothing to fix at all. But practice this merely to get familiar with it. Don't try to say, well, how do I use this? No, that's not the right practice. Familiarity is the right practice. So there's nothing to fix. Every time I say that, I'm getting more used to that. There's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. Wow, 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 there's nothing to fix. Wow. Just getting familiar with it. There's nothing to fix. Wow. Temporarily, we feel a little bit, tired and shocked, strained. But that's nothing compared to if we don't do this practice. If we don't do this practice, then we're going to, be inundated by the deluge that's to come in this world. Deluge of stress, turmoil, and every which way. Absurdity at play. Absurdity trying to fix problems like overpopulation. Absurdity does have a plan, attempted fix of overpopulation, ecological issues in the world, all of that. Absurdity most definitely has a plan, and it's pushing towards that, trying to. Whereas others say, no. We think that Jesus has a plan, right? We don't need to go about it the way that absurdity tells us to go about it. Because really, familiarity problem is the only problem there is. Jesus says we're already there, we're already home, we never left, but we need to get familiar with this fact, is what I'm saying. We think, well, how come I don't realize it? Because we have a bias against realizing that, because we can't fit that truth into absurdity. And so we say, "Why? That's very unfamiliar. I want to feel familiar. I want to stick with absurdity, but fit truth into it somehow. That never works. Can't work. That in itself is absurdity. That's absurd." So there's nothing to fix. There is nothing to fix, and there's nothing to fix. There's never anything to fix. There is never anything to fix. So we're just hearing this. And we're saying, wow, I'm hearing this. Wow. I didn't expect to ever hear something like this. Quite a shock. Quite a shock. So this is a real strong, super strong practice here. And if you've been practicing all along, you'll be able to practice this one. And it's super powerful. Super, super, super powerful. There's nothing to fix. If you're willing, when you're willing to practice like this, your external circumstances, it's not external, they're really just the mind's experiencing what it wants to experience, that will reflect in such a way as to enable us to keep practicing this way and reassure us reassure us that this is so. So we will find ourselves in situations that feel like everything's fine. There's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. Very interesting, to say the least. I can confirm this too. So you have an ally here, all of the world who really wants to get free of absurdity has a big ally right here. We need to rely on our allies at this time, our friends. And so I can tell you, since I've already, you know, been working on this so intensely, I've already had some success in this regard. So let me explain this, how this works. Indeed, it did work that way for me. I did say in May, late May, I did take a short trip out of the Bay Area. We attended a wedding, and then we had a little bit of a couple days vacation after that before we came back to the Bay Area. And the upshot of this was the experience was one where we were staying. The experience was like everything was perfect. There's nothing needed to be fixed at all. But it was very practical, pragmatic, like the faucet and the shower, everything worked perfectly and was so solid and stable. The doors, the way they swing, I just noticed. I said, hey, do you notice that, like, this house feels like there's nothing wrong with it at all? And other people said, yeah, I mean, I get the same impression. The carpet, it just feels like you don't need to fix anything here. It was like, I felt like I don't need to touch a thing. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to fix anything here. It's just the way it is. It's just perfect. Just fine. Just amazing. It was so noticeable. The paint. I said, look at this paint. I mean, everything just looks like it's going to last forever. It's never going to need to be fixed. How do they do this? The quality of all the hardware there was such that you can't even buy that quality these days. It's all junk these days. Nothing lasts really very well these days, no matter what you pay. But there, it's just you feel like this stuff is never going to break. It's never going to need fixing. This is the impression, very strong impression. So this is a perfect example of how our external circumstances, not external, but our environment, you might say, tends to then reflect what our mind is focused on and our goal. So my goal is there's nothing to fix, to realize there's nothing to fix. So I get this experience of living in a situation where I felt there's nothing to fix. And it was wonderful. The yard minimal, and there's a homeowner association where all that's taken care of. The plumbing ran flawlessly. You know, you just think like, I'm not going to have any problems at all here. There's nothing to fix. So I got a little dose of that, a little dose. And I said, I loved it. I said, wow, this is really cool, really nice, very wow. So this is how it works, is what we're experiencing will reflect what we want to experience. If you want to have lots of problems to solve, you'll be in a place where there's lots of problems. You'll experience lots of problems. Everything's always breaking. Whereas if you're work practicing saying there's nothing to fix, then you will gravitate and find yourself in that situation where you feel everything just works great. This also refers to our body, to the body. If there's nothing to fix, there's nothing to fix. I was having a conversation yesterday with a friend, and I told him a little bit about my life where I had a lot of troubles because I said I was trying to fix everyone's problems. When I was young, I felt like I was my duty to solve all problems in the world. Because people said, you've come to help. You said you could help us get free of our problems. So you can make us happy. Well, we'll be happy, said we got to fix our problems. So then I got pulled into trying to, and I felt like I had to fix everyone's problem. So my mind was constantly, I had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of problems just going through my mind constantly. I couldn't sleep. People said, "What happened to you? Why'd you get sick?" They didn't understand. It was because I was trying to fix everyone's problems. You see unhappiness everywhere. You just see whatever, anything. I saw a plant. Oh, I need to, it needs to be better. Sidewalk, it needs to be better. A car, anything. Just problems everywhere, right? And I felt I have to solve that. I have to somehow help solve that problem. And it's just infinite problems. And so I was burdened by the sense of infinite problems, and trying to come up with strategy to resolve all these problems. Of course, then no time to sleep. Can't shut the mind off like that. So I just went decades and decades and decades not having hardly any sleep at all, which makes you chronically extremely fatigued, and your immune system goes really bad. Catch everything that comes around you, catch it, just stay constantly sick. So I said, "Wow, this is not working out well." Right? So the Holy Spirit has helped me come to this point now where I see there's nothing to fix, actually. There's nothing to fix. We actually, it's all a dream. Problems are just nothing but make-believe, pretending, a dream. We don't need to fix dream problems. The purpose of problems, again, is to try to learn how to change what we are. And since we cannot change what we are, the learning curriculum just, as long as we hold that desire, it just goes on indefinitely, and that you'll always come upon more and more, problems to work on. So, and the more frustrated you get, the more severe the problems become, until ultimately you feel you got to solve all the problems in the universe. Dust landed on something. Ah, it's a problem. I got to figure out how to get rid of all dust. Yeah. And I got to figure out how to, everybody has a million complaints if you really dig into it, right? But they're all dream complaints. We don't need to solve problems, dream problems. We need to just relinquish the dreaming, relinquish dreaming. Can we dream a dream of no problems? The Holy Spirit apparently has one for us, a dream of no problems, yeah. But that would be giving a different purpose to dreaming. And ultimately, we don't need to dream at all. But having a dream of no problems would certainly help us get familiar with the notion of no problems, nothing to fix, nothing to fix, nothing to fix. The thing is, if we're dreaming, we think we could always change that. It's like a safety net. We could always change it, dream problems if we want to. So it gives us like a security blanket there. But then ultimately it resolves to just, we realize there's problems are impossible. But we don't want to see problems are impossible too quickly. A little bird. Hello, bird. Ah, nice. Cute little bird. The birds have showed up. So these little birds have suddenly showed up here. They must know I'm taping. Hello, birds. I made a cameo there. Very nice. Very nice. Boy, that shifts the mood, doesn't it? Hi, bird. Ah. Let's see if they'll come on down and pay a visit here. They're looking for food right now. Wow, bird's hanging upside down, and it flew upside down to the next branch like that. That's amazing. It can fly upside down. Huh. Very agile, this bird, as it's hopping from branch to branch. Wow, what a display of agility and nimbleness. I think exercise-wise, we should practice hopping sideways, kind of, or hopping a certain way. Quick, agile adjustment sideways to avoid the troubles that are coming. Now, if we look at nature, there's infinite things to fix, right? All the plants, if you walk around, you see that needs to be pruned, that needs to be cleaned up, this needs to be watered, this needs to be fertilized, you know, this needs to be changed here. People like parks because they feel like, I don't need to fix anything here, and it's all maintained so nicely. You just say, ah, I don't have to worry about my yard here in the park. You know, it's so nice. If you think we need to maintain nature, then nature is this endless monster. Now, if people have money, they pay someone else to do it, of course. And so they feel that they're free. But the problem is then, how do you keep getting money? You see? They're fearful, well, I don't have enough money. I can't pay someone to take care of all the dirty work. You know, what's going to happen then? So they become very driven towards greed to feeling that'll give them happiness, and once they have happiness, then they'll be nice to everybody. But does that mean nature stops dropping leaves? No, it doesn't, does it? Drought stop happening? No. So there's nothing to fix. There is nothing to fix. So again, that little anecdote I told you about what happened, what I experienced, is super, super important. I literally decided I was willing to give this new way a try. And this is really the root of the new way. The wow practice is the new way. And the wow practice enables us to use these new assertions that are have not really been used in history very much. In the highest practices, they have been. But you don't hear that hardly at all these days. To someone say, there's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. Okay, that includes everything. I cannot find anything to fix because there's nothing to fix. I cannot find anything to fix at all because there's nothing to fix. It's useless to go searching for something to fix because there's nothing to fix. It's useless to go searching to continue my search for something to fix because there's nothing to fix. There's nothing that needs to be fixed. There's nothing that needs any fixing whatsoever. So the search to find something that needs fixing is absurd. Absurd. So give up the search. Throw the search overboard. There's nothing that needs to be fixed. Nothing needs to be fixed. Wow. Nothing needs to be fixed. Wow. Nothing needs to be fixed. Wow. Well, those little birds have moved on just that quick. They just came to this tree, had a little snack, and they're off to the next tree, which has a different snack for them. Kind of a nice life. Yeah. So the pacing of this type of practice is very important. We do not want to go after this practice as if there's something to fix. So the attitude, the fixing it attitude, it says, okay, just tell me what needs fixing, I'll do it. They hear this practice, they say, there's nothing needs fixing. Okay, I'll do that, and that'll fix it. And then they say, like, you know, okay, the next week I'm going to say this, 500,000 times, and that should fix the problem. That's the wrong context and attitude. We're dealing with a familiarity bias, okay, and this familiarity bias is very, very severe. So when we say there's nothing that needs fixing, there's nothing to fix, nothing that needs to be fixed, there's nothing that needs to be fixed, this is quite shocking. Even if we say it three times, it's quite shocking. So we have to have patience to back off of it for a little bit. Back off of it for a little bit. Full stop in the wow. Back off. Whereas someone who has this fix-it mentality is saying, "I'm not stopping till it's fixed." Okay. But we're just saying there's nothing to fix. We're saying that. Okay, but we have to get familiar with it. The only fixing is familiarity. But there's this shock problem and the need to block panic. So the world probably assumes that I'm getting left behind because I don't have this fix-it mentality and I haven't, set up my future here at all. And I don't have any assets, and I haven't set up my future at all. From their way of looking at it, from their way of looking at it. And I have no fix-it kind of initiative at all. I haven't set up my future, I've set up my now, actually. And my now doesn't need a future. Hallelujah. I haven't set up my future, I've set up my now, and my now doesn't need a future. Wow. I haven't set up my future, I've set up my now, and my now doesn't need a future. Hallelujah. Doesn't need a past either. But future, we'll say it's more relevant, I believe. So I haven't set up my future, I've set up my now, and my now doesn't need a future. Wow. Little ants. Ants are everywhere, aren't they? So this is hitting really hard again. Just as saying this a few times is when you speak truth with conviction, it only takes several times to really shock, feel the shock. Quite shocking, this one. I haven't set up my future. I've set up my now, and my now doesn't need a future. Wow. Very, very, very profound practice here. I haven't set up any future. I've set up my now. And the now doesn't need any future. I haven't set up any future. I've set up the now. And the now doesn't need any future. Wow. So, if I got this fabulous place to stay 2 months ago, that was before I really launched this the new way practice. So we've been at this new way practice now over 2 months. Or did we start it on June 4th? If we did, we've been at it 2 months. 2 months on the new way practice. I think today's the 5th. Yeah. I think it was officially launched the 4th, June 4th. So we've been at it now for 2 months. Isn't that great? Happy 2 month anniversary. Or completed, because we had to complete the 4th day. Let's call it that way. August 4th. So. Congratulations, everyone. 2 months of the new way practice. So, what's my experience going to be going forward? We don't say the future, but just going forward, moment by moment. How's that going to take be how's it going to be? I don't think about it so much, but It's very wowish just to even consider it. It's going to be better. It's going to be better. It can only get better. And the place where I was two months ago was tremendous. You know, it was everything. I could hardly, you know, I said, don't, I didn't want to pinch myself. Is this a dream? Is this a dream? I said, it's so beautiful. And I wouldn't change a thing. I don't need to fix anything. I don't need to do anything to fix. No fixing is required. No problems to be solved. I don't need to solve any problems. I don't need to fix anything. And everything will just continue to working perfectly without me doing anything about it, trying to maintain it or anything. It's just automatically maintained. Automatically maintained. Wow. So my experiencing is headed towards something even better than that. Way better than that, actually. But even the same for a longer time would be great. Right? Yeah. That's possible. The same for a longer time and experience it more fully and feel more comfortable with it. That's certain to happen. I feel that. It's certain to happen. Even though I have no funding at all, personally at this point, I feel it's certain to happen. As I'm preparing for it, it's certain to happen. I trust in Jesus when he says there's this dynamic. It cannot be, and all the Dharma kings say this. You know, your experiencing will be what you're willing to be familiar with, what your familiarity is, and what your beliefs are. So I believe that I don't need to fix anything. That'll be my experiencing. It'll correlate with that. It'll reinforce it. Our experiencing reinforces what we desire to experience. It supports it. It's in support. Our experiencing is always in support of what we want to experience. The universe wants to experience absurdity. We have a universe. We want to experience no absurdity at all, truth. We have an experience that cannot be called a universe, actually. Maybe a now verse, a here and now verse. Yeah. So I would be experiencing a here and now verse, a here and now verse, actually. A more here and more now verse than expected. Frame of reference shift. I'm already feeling a more here and more now verse than expected. Wow. Frame of reference shift. I'm already feeling a more now and more here verse than expected. The here and now verse. So the frame of reference shift from the universe to the here and now verse. I'm already feeling the here and now verse more than expected. Wow. I'm already experiencing the here and now verse more than expected. Wow. So don't pinch yourself. This is you're really hearing all of this, and you know part of you is saying, I didn't know I'd ever hear this. You know, this is just amazing. Wow. Because you can feel the relevancy, right? You can feel the safety of it, the relevancy and safety. I got to be careful. I don't hurt this little ant. There you go. Don't try to brush it off. The little insects are so fragile that if you try to brush them off, they get ruined. So I got it to go on my finger, and then the finger's nice and smooth and easy to just like that. Okay. So those who are experiencing problems again, that's reinforcing their desire, what they want to experience. They want to be able to change what they are, so they're going to end up having very severe problems to try to, you know, believe that say, wow, that there's really a huge opportunity here. There's so much I can learn. There's so much I can fix that I feel like I can really learned so much that I feel it's possible to change what I am. At least, certainly, I see a pathway. I see a road that'll, you know, seems to be leading there. At least a road of hope. So, you end up putting, you know, yourself in a situation. You have experiencing that supportive of this, you know, long, winding, difficult road of learning and evolving and changing and fixing problems. And you might be in a, you know, really difficult. So many challenges, all this kind of stuff. That's by design, you see. So as far as feeling sorry for anybody in the world, no, everybody's experiencing exactly what they need, what is supportive of exactly what they believe they want. There's no mistake in that. Everything is perfect. Everything's working perfectly. Our experiencing is supporting our desire, what we want to experience. If we want to try and change what we are, then our experience seems to be an opportunity to try and change what we are. To try through this long, winding road of problems, difficulties, challenges. And we feel like, you know, great. I mean, I'm always amazed. I work with people, and some of them like are laborers, okay, like jackhammers and digging ditches all day. I mean, just, you know, the heaviest kind of hard labor, and they're as happy as can be. In fact, I asked someone, I said, you know, what, you know, wow, it's so hot. He says, no, I love this, man. I love it. You got more for me? I said, what do you mean more? I mean, you just broke up all this concrete for days. It's like, must have killed you out in 100 plus temperature. He goes, yeah, it's hot, but I said, I love this. I love this stuff. I said, well, there's a lot of concrete to break in the world. He said, well, yeah, bring it on. I'm like, what? For me, it's like abhorrent, you know. It's just like, I'm shocked. I said, what? I want to help you, you know, get free of this. No, what? No. They don't want to get free of it. They want to succeed. For them, it's an opportunity to generate hope that they can change what they are. So they love the world. They said, this world, I love the world. I mean, look at how much opportunity there is to work on stuff, to learn, to fix things. So many sick people. I'm always amazed, like nurses, people, doctors. I said, I can't even imagine doing this. I cannot even imagine anything like this. I cannot even imagine sickness. And I say, is this like total torture? They go, well, no, I love helping people. I love helping, you know, helping them people deal with sickness and helping overcome these challenges. I just love it. People love their work. And I don't get it. I wouldn't love any of that stuff at all. It's just horror for me. Absolute horror. Absolute absurdity. So I love just sitting here practicing like this. And I think most people in the world look at me and with horrified by, oh my God, you know, that's like torture. That's so scary. I want to give me some, you know, some concrete to bust up. I'd much rather do that. Are you kidding me? I mean, the jobs that people do, oh man, I've seen a lot. And but they're smiling, they're laughing, they're joking. I can't wait to get to work. I said, buddy, this is horrible, isn't it? Nope, they say, no, it beats not working, you know. So they view me, this like, it's not working. And to them, that's terrifying because they think absurdity is God. And they're not serving absurdity unless they're working on some fix to fix something. So they're terrified of not working. I had a dream recently that told me, says, you don't have to work anymore. This dream told me, you won't have to work anymore. I said, that's amazing because, okay, I won't ask how that's possible, but what a dream is saying, you literally do not have to work anymore. You're done with working forever. You're done with working. What a great feeling that is. There's nothing I need to do. I don't have to work. How can I say in a practice? I never have to work again. I'll never have to work again. I don't have to work at all. There's no work that I need to do. There's nothing I need to fix. If there's nothing I need to fix, there's nothing I need to do. There's absolutely nothing I need to do. I need not work anymore. I need not work anymore. Wow. There's no need to work anymore. I have no more need to work anymore. So I'll work on that one. There's the work. So the only work I have to do is to work on this. But it's easy work. It's the work I want to do. So I need not work anymore. I don't have to work anymore. Wow. I do not have to work any longer. Wow. I am totally done with work. Wow. There is no work to do. Wow. There is no work to do. I don't have to work because there is no work to do. I don't have to work because there is no work to do. I don't have to work because there is no work to do. I don't have to work because there is no work to do. I don't have to work because there is no work to do. I've never had to work. I'll never have to work. And I don't need to work now. I've never had to work. I'll never have to work. And I don't need to work now. Wow. Now this will eventuate in experiencing where the here and now verse is totally supportive of not needing to work. Not needing to work. But what do we do? Enjoy. What do you mean enjoy? Enjoy the here and now verse. When we say enjoy this world, the people say, well, wait a minute. See, no, I'm not saying enjoy this world. This world only appears in support of absurdity. I'm saying enjoy the here and now verse. So when I said previously that this video channel here is for those in the world, all my friends, which is everyone, to follow along and see, you know, how does this go? Because you should be very curious about this. See, he's practicing in this way. How is his experiencing going to be? How is that going to be? You see, really key of importance, right, for your motivation. Does the universe support this type of practicing? To say, I've never needed to work. I'll never have to work, and I don't need to work now. Wow. There's nothing to fix. I am being wow. I'm enjoying the here and now verse more than expected. I'm already feeling enjoyment of the here and now verse more than expected. I'm already feeling enjoyment of the here and now verse more than expected. Wow. So it's really important for motivation to realize that you will be supported. So this trip I did take is, you know, a gift to the world. The last one in May, late May, it's a great gift to the world because I was able to verify that indeed the new way, I committed, said I'll do the new way, and the new way says, okay, just in support of your commitment to do that, this is going to be your experiencing. And it was so fabulous. So how about in now? I've done it for 2 months. That's even better. Committing to do it is one thing, but doing it is even stronger, isn't it? That's really, really, really getting it done. As anyone can promise something, but then following through on the promise is where it's really at. So again, what is my experiencing going to be like now? I'm very excited about it in terms of, yeah, seeing this, like, wow, I don't need to work at all. I've never needed to work. I'll never need to work. There's no work to do, actually. There's nothing that needs to be fixed. There's nothing that needs to be fixed at all. There's no problems that need to be solved. There's nothing that needs to be fixed. There's nothing to fix. Wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. So this is like a great experiment, actually, here. A great experiment, the ultimate scientific experiment. Test and see what the results are. That's called science. We're really doing science here. The highest kind of science. So, will my the universe, will the here and now verse support my desire to enjoy the here and now verse? Right? This is the what this test, scientific testing, is designed to determine. And we won't know that unless somebody tests it out, right? I've always been very scientific, but in a high way, in the right way, to really apply science in its most relevant form, really. And this is it right here. Will the here and now verse support one who is resolving the familiarity problem concerning it? And I don't know, so I just have to believe it's going to be even better. I'll tell you, that experience in late May was way better than I expected. Well, let's just say more than I expected. It was all everything I could do to just to wow it. I was in shock. I said, is this a dream? I said, really? In a little old me, I've never done anything. And this is what I get? It's just shocking. This is what a billionaire should get. Somebody who's like, made a, a billion cars or something, or heads this corporation that makes all refrigerators, and someone who is solving the problems of the rainforest. I mean, they should be rewarded in this way. So they, but I'm the ones being rewarded. A carefree experience. I'm the ones being rewarded, and I don't have a penny. Really, extra. I've never done anything except test this out. But that's the most important thing to do, actually. So I haven't done anything except the most important thing to do. The problem is with most, they try to do everything else also, and they never have time for the most important thing to do. They never end up testing it out. Because, of course, they're still staying loyal to absurdity. And absurdity tells us this won't work. See, absurdity says that, this is crazy. This won't work. But how do we know that's so if we don't test it? And so he says, well, why even test it out? It can't work. It can't work. Well, it has been working. So everyone's really following along here, and being part of the most important work and test here, scientific endeavor. The most important endeavor here is to put this to the test. So I'm not interested in following other stuff in the world because this is, infinitely more relevant. The world, the rest of the world is not testing out anything of relevance. It's just trying to attain the results for absurdity, which is how to change what we are, which has never worked. So they're just trying to do more of the same. So there's really nothing to see there at all, actually, in the world. What's going on in the world? There's nothing to see there. Been there, done that. It's like repeating the same experiments, hoping for a different result. which is sort of the definition of insanity. Beautiful day. Is that a blue jay I was hearing? I think it was. It's been a long time since I've seen a blue jay here in the yard. Hey, blue jay, where are you? That squawking? There's a blue jay around somewhere. Maybe we'll see it. So my focus really has to be not on that I'm going to experience something terrible, but I'm going to experience something better than I expect. My expectations are already very high. I mean, but it's going to be even better than that. It's like, wow. Well, enjoyment of the here and now verse. People say they don't want to be sick. Yes, they do. Because they're serving absurdity, and absurdity says, try this. And they say, okay, let me try. So here's a sickness you need to get well from. There's a challenge for you. And this will help. Absurdity says, this will help the cause. You know, this will help your learning. This is advancing you towards heaven, towards something wonderful. But you just have to learn how to fix stuff, how to make stuff well, how to get better. How to solve problems, how to meet challenges. It's all an evolutionary process of consciousness, it's absurdity says. And so they say, well, at least I got something to work on here. This is great. I can make some progress here with this. Can I beat cancer? Can I, you know, like that? Can I, yeah. They like to beat illnesses. Everyone I meet seems to have trouble, illness problems. They say, well, I got over this. And then a little while later, another illness comes up. And it's always like that. Something new to, something troublesome to battle against. Something troublesome to battle against. But really, there's nothing troublesome to battle against at all. There's nothing troublesome to battle against at all. There is no trouble. There is no trouble whatsoever. Wow. There is no trouble whatsoever. Wow. There is no trouble whatsoever. Wow. There is no trouble. There's never been any trouble. There never will be any trouble, and there's no trouble now. None whatsoever. There is no trouble whatsoever. Wow. Wow, 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 I am being wow, I am being wow, I am being wow, full stop in the wow, I am being wow. This one really hit hard, shockwaves. But just saying that saves thousands of years of misery, actually. Thousands of years, just saying it one time like this. And experiencing this shock will last like for what, 5-10 minutes maybe or so. I feel a little tired for the rest of the day, but in doing so I save myself thousands of years of battling against severe troubles. So you talk about a good deal, there it is. So for just a little down, feeling a little bit down, the shock here, I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. We save ourselves vast suffering, vast amount of battles against wicked troubles, vicious troubles. So how foolish it is to not do this, right? How foolish it is to not do this. Now, I was going to do a bunch of little things today, this, this, and that. But this taping here has been so important. I can still do some things today, but just an epic, epic video here. So I use the vitality of the morning to do this, but we're going to use the vitality of our mornings somehow every day, right? Having a nighttime, at the end of the day, we're worn out, and so why not use it this way? In the most effective way possible. Instead of going out and breaking concrete up, digging up a tree, you know, digging a ditch, planting this, planting that, raking this, doing this and this and that, whatever you do, endless efforts, why not use your vitality of the morning in this way and get tired in this way? Doesn't preclude, I took a walk this morning, it doesn't preclude taking a walk. So the wise use their vitality this way, right? And down the road, well, for them, there won't be any down the road, actually. There'll be the here and now verse. There is no road to absurdity. The beginning and ending of absurdity are simultaneous, with nothing in between. There's no room for any road at all. There's no space for any road at all. There's no time for any road at all. The beginning and ending of absurdity are the same. They're the same. Simultaneous, and even more than that, they're actually exactly the same. Beginning and the ending are exactly the same. And there's nowhere, therefore, to go at all. There's nowhere for absurdity to go at all. So there's really no road at all. We're just dreaming of hope, hoping there'll be a road, hoping there's a road, hoping there's a road. There's really no road at all. We never left the here and now verse, actually. We're just pretending that we entered a universe of time, space, process, and form. But we really didn't. We didn't. We're just dreaming it, imagining it, pretending it. The beginning and the ending of absurdity are exactly the same, simultaneous. So if the beginning of something and the ending of it are simultaneous, where's the extension of it? Where's the life of it? It's just a dead image. Here in Navverse, we don't even have to wait for enjoyment. We don't have to wait for something to be fixed first. So it's here now. It's more here now than expected. It already feels more here now than expected. It already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. The here and now verse. Wow. Frame of reference shift. The here and now verse already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. The here and now verse already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. It's a way of familiarity, okay? Building in familiarity here. The here and now verse already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. I am wow. My status is wow. My familiarity is wow. Frame of reference shift. Wow. The here and now verse already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. So very intense. I'm feeling this. That means it really hit a nerve, which means it really dug deep into the familiarity expectations of absurdity and really is working on them, dissolving them very strongly. So I'm not sure what to expect next. You see, this is the feeling of shock, like, wow, that really dissolved my expectations, my familiarity expectations. Severely so, I don't know what to expect next. And so it's shocking. And then we block them. So I'm going to experience the wow. I am experiencing the wow right now. I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. So I only have one problem, I only have one problem, I only have one problem. That's the familiarity problem. But it's a very severe problem. Just one problem, but a very severe problem, the familiarity problem. And the wow practice resolves the familiarity problem. Wow. The wow practice resolves the familiarity problem into the here and now verse. Wow. And to experience the enjoyment of the here and now verse. Wow. There's only one problem. I only have one problem. There's only one problem. The familiarity problem. But it's a very severe problem. The wow, the new way wow practice resolves the familiarity problem into the enjoyment of the here and now verse more than expected. Wow. There you go. Full on practice there. There is only one problem, and none other, the familiarity problem. But it's a very severe problem. The new way wow practice resolves the familiarity problem into enjoyment of the here and now verse. More here, which feels more here and more now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more now and more here than expected. Wow. So there's only one problem, and no other, the familiarity problem. But it's a very, 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 very severe problem. It's the most severe. So there's only one problem. You know, it's got to be the most severe, right? There's only one problem, the familiarity problem, and it's very severe. The new way WOW practice resolves the familiarity problem into enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and now than expected WOW, which already feels more here and now than expected WOW, which already feels more here and more now than expected WOW, WOW, WOW. There is only one problem and no other, the familiarity problem, but it's very severe. The new way practice resolves the familiarity problem into enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and more now than expected. Wow, wow, wow. If I weren't doing this, I'd probably be like a jazz pianist in Nordstrom's. You walk into Nordstrom's and there's this pianist, you know, just tickling the ivories. And, you know, you play something beautiful for a little while, then suddenly just you shift into this different style, and that's beautiful too. Then you shift into this other style. Yeah, I'd probably be one of those in a coat and tail playing a piano in Nordstrom's. I probably would be. Yeah. I'd be that guy. Play a little Chopin and then do some jazz kind of thing. And the little slip key kind of classic country sort of thing. A little improvisational, soft, you know, mood music. Titled Summertime, you know. And then just, you know, just shifting these moods, shifting this practice, shifting the shift a little bit. But everything is really nice. Really, oh, that's nice. Oh, I really like that. I like that. But I'm not the Nordstrom guy. I don't need to work. I've never needed to work. I never will need to work. There is no work to do. There is no work to do. Only enjoyment of the here and now verse. There is no work to do. Only enjoyment of the here and now verse. So there is no work to do. So this resolves into just pure enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. So we don't want to overdo it. Like I overdid my exercising, physical exercising last, it's been a week now, I think the last Saturday. I probably did it Sunday too, but I overdid it. And really caused a reaction in my system, overall system. Still recovering from that. So, but it'll recover. It did before, but I just have to not overdo it. So we're not going to overdo this practicing now. This is, I'd like to go on and on and on and on and on, but we also need to take a bit of a rest in between. So that's why we do videos every most days. Take a rest, recover. We've spent a lot of vitality on this today already. You'll get some of it back. But again, you know, it's effort well spent here. Super well spent. There's only one problem, the familiarity problem, and there is no other problem whatsoever. We can say this, there is no what problem you want to say. There is no world problem. There's only a familiarity problem. The familiarity problem is the only problem there is no other. But this problem is very severe. The new way practice resolves the familiarity problem into enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Now, it's already August, which means September's coming, which is football season. Ah, my gosh. I just like August just to continue indefinitely, actually. That's my goal. Beautiful month. Beautiful month. Yesterday, it was all overcast, like it was going to be some sort of, it was broody and moody and heavy and humid and overcast. We almost never get that here. It was so beautiful. Everything felt different, looked different. It's like, wow. But today it's all clear again. A few little clouds drifting around. But soft atmosphere. We don't have a suffering problem, we have a familiarity problem. The suffering problem doesn't exist. Only the familiarity problem is the only problem there is. But it's very severe. The new way, wow practice, resolves the familiarity problem into enjoyment of the here and now verse, which is already more here and more now than expected. Wow. I don't know what to do after this video. I can't really work out. I've got to rest. But maybe resting is a thing to do. That this video has really caused a title change, really. Fabulous. I love it. I don't want to stop. There is no world crisis problem. There's only a familiarity problem. Familiarity problem is the only problem there is. There isn't any other problem. But the familiarity problem is very severe. The new way wow practice resolves the familiarity problem into enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and more now than expected. Wow. There are no world problems to fix. There's only the familiarity problem. There is no other problem. But the familiarity problem is very severe. The new way wow practice resolves the familiarity problem into enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and more now than expected. Wow. Wow, wow, I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. Similar to working out physically, you do a set of something and then you relax and recover for a little while. You do your curls and you take a break for 5 minutes or so. Catch your breath. Catch your breath. What we don't want to do is two things. Not a marathon. We don't want to do a marathon of straight practicing. We can do a long video if it's broken, interspersed with you know, cool down periods. And we don't want to do too much practicing straight without a cool down period. So those are the two mistakes that we must avoid here. If we do a real long video, like a 5 hour video, 3.5 hour video, there needs to be times where we're chatting about something, where we're relaxing and we're not, you know, we're taking it easy. We might even do that for 5, 10, 20 minutes to catch our breath, and then we can go back to some more practicing like that. Very important. The pacing is very important. And we cannot do a video like, let's say, for 30 minutes where just intense practicing, that's overdoing it, going too fast, trying to overdo it and go too fast. The backlash will be very severe from that. That is what happened to me, swinging the golf club. I was feeling so good. I said, I think I can really, I don't know, again, I just did it too much. It swung too hard. I swung too hard. The problem is my muscles are able to swing really hard, but my back can only take so much. That's the thing, right? You can't make your vertebrae, your spine, stronger, really. You can make the muscles around it stronger. But that only enables you to swing even harder. So if you get really, the stronger you get, the more you have to ease off a little bit, and don't do it too much. It's going to overstrain. So don't do it too fast, and if you do it a long practice period, make sure you have breaks in it. Not stay where you are, you know, but just relax from the effort just a little while. Let the shock wear off. You have to let the shock wear off. which is what we're doing right now. Catch your breath. Sprint, catch your breath. Sprint, catch your breath. Sprint, catch your breath. Don't sprint too far without stopping. And don't try like running all day long. You're going to overdo it. And this type of practice we're doing here, especially you don't want to overdo it. You'll find yourself parting ways then here, with this channel. If you try to overdo it, you're going to find yourself leaving, because the backlash will be so severe that you're going to go look for comfort somewhere else. But just practicing a little bit with conviction is extremely helpful. If your life is busy, it's busy in order to distract you, so you don't have much time to practice. But you still have some time to practice, and you can even do it in the midst of your business. As you're doing stuff, you say, there's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. As you're walking, you can say, there's nothing to fix. As you're driving, you say, there's nothing to fix. Wow. Whatever you're doing, there's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. Very great. And what's going on? A bunch of noise there. Wow. The cat is here saying, what's going on, cat? I don't know what that was. A big disturbance there. There's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. The cat still doesn't know what happened. There's nothing to fix. Wow. Cat, what happened, huh? Wow, there was a big commotion there. The cat's now walking this direction, so the commotion is gone. But there was a big commotion there. So there's nothing to fix. Wow. Nothing to fix. Wow. We didn't jump up, get up. There's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. There's nothing to fix. Wow. And again, this resolves into pure enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Now when if you overdo it, you're gonna eat too much. It compounds itself. You just feel so sluggish. Maybe I eat some more, have some energy. So we don't want to, we want to go fast, but not too fast. We certainly want to go fast, but not too fast. Okay, this is really key. I mean, there's a point in your car, if you're going really fast, and then you go too fast, you realize, then you slow way down and say, wow, that's too scary. So you just have to push it, but not too much. Not a marathon. Don't sit down and say, I'm going to do this for the next 12 hours. No. No, 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 no. That's a big no-no. Very big no-no. That's the ego. That's absurdity, the familiarity, the absurdity saying, hey, I want to bail out of this, so I need an excuse, though. So I'll just do too much practice, and then I'll want to bail out of it, and then I'll say, ah, this doesn't work, you know, bad effects, you know, okay, that's why I'm leaving, bailing out of it. That's what happens. So, but absurdity says, no, see, I'm really into it, it's just, this isn't good enough for me, I need something better. That's absurdity. This is good enough for everyone. Saying there's nothing to fix, that's good enough for everyone, that's true for everyone. Familiarity wants to go back to, we want to go back to the arms of absurdity because we're so used to it. But we don't want to, and we don't want to do it by claiming we are going back to the arms of absurdity. We want to say, no, I want even more spirituality. So I need to go faster. This isn't fast. Okay, so in other words, it's rationalizing it. So we don't recognize we're going back to absurdity. Spiritualizing absurdity. Whenever I try to do something Holy Spirit doesn't want, the computer crashes. It's amazing. I want to go back to graphics. No, nothing works. You know, the computer stops working for me. But it's working for this video, which is great. Which is really great, because this is what needs to be done. This is what needs to be heard right now. Sticking to the practice. Sticking to the practice. Sticking to the practice. Which resolves into the pure enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. 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 Interesting, that severe commotion there. Severe commotion. But we didn't break our practice, did we? But the cat was attracted to it, wasn't she? She absolutely was. Had to go investigate. Curiosity kills the cat, right? But here we say, you know what? As long as it doesn't impinge on our practicing, whatever, right? Because really, we don't have a commotion problem. We have a familiarity problem. The familiarity problem is the only problem there is. There is no other problem. The new way practice resolves the familiarity problem into pure enjoyment of the here and now verse, which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more here and now than expected. Wow. Which already feels more here and more now than expected. Wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. I am being wow. Don't tell anybody you're practicing, just do it. Because that's a one-way ticket back to absurdity. You tell anybody you're practicing like this. This is very advanced practicing. It actually works. And most of the world doesn't want that. They want to say that they do spiritual stuff, but stay in the arms of absurdity. Like, do you meditate? Oh yeah, I meditate. I do some yoga, I meditate. Everybody has a little bit of spirituality, most people in their lives, right? Most. Oh yeah, yeah, I feel, you know, do what I'm doing. It's very spiritual. Meanwhile, right, they're racking up familiarity with absurdity. 24/7, 24/7. Since they think absurdity is the road to salvation, they don't want to be pulled off of it by any, you know, true spiritual teaching. So they want to kind of block that by saying, well, I do enough spiritual stuff, you know. Sometimes I pray a little prayer. When's the last time I prayed? I don't know. Can't quite remember. How about meditation? When was the last time you meditated? I try to do a meditation. You know, when the spirit moves me, I don't remember the last time I meditated. But you know, when I feel like it, I can meditate a little bit, a little quiet time. When's the last time you spent some quiet time? Some dedicated quiet time. Don't ask, right? Don't ask. Why are you asking these questions, right? Well, right, it's illustrative of that's absurdist spirituality. And here we can say, well, we just did 2 hours of it, basically, right? It's almost there. Well, we just did two. So Saturday, when was the last time you meditated or practiced or whatever, spiritual? Well, this morning, Saturday morning. Two hours of ultra-intense, focused practicing, which was super effective. Yeah, just this Saturday, which was just today. I did it today, actually. Wow. Wow and wow. So how's my experience, how's the here and now verse going to support my experiencing based on this practice momentum right now? This is a very interesting question. And so that's my next phase, is to experience this. Experience this. So we'll let this get to 2 hours, and then we'll say, okay, 2 hours is really great. We did 2 hours this morning, nice round number, and we did 2 hours this morning. Wow, wow, and wow. Yeah, all right, very great. The new way is wow, the new way is wow, the new way is wow.